The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Marshall. The world you're about to visit isn't the world you know. It's an alien planet, so distant, so remote, so anonymous, that it bears a number instead of a name. It's a world called A-15. And while it may be light years away in distance and many years away in time, we're going to take you there right now. You'll travel with four others, young but seasoned veterans of spaceflight, the kind of tough, resilient young men the rigors of space will demand. Ready for anything? Well, almost anything.
Askia! Askia! What are you shooting at?
Look, Carpenter! It is a frog! A giant frog!
You're out of your mind, Askia. There isn't any animal life on this planet.
Look! Behind the heat! What do you call that thing?
It's impossible. Carpenter, this whole planet is impossible.
Our drama, The Eleventh Plague, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Henry Slessor and stars Russell Horton. I'll be back shortly with Act One. The Northwest headquarters of the USSC. No, those initials aren't familiar to you yet, but they're famed the world over in the year of our story, 2065 AD. They stand for United States Space Command, and it's the military arm of the nation's space program, a program which has expanded to the stars thanks to the astonishing rate of development in space flight. But while the technology has changed dramatically, some things remain very much the same, especially human emotions.
Captain Joel Taylor reporting, sir.
Oh, yes, Captain. Come on in. I understand you've seen your orders.
Well, no, sir, not really. All I've been told was that the mission starts in 9 weeks and that I'm supposed to pick a crew of three.
That's right. And since it's a 3-year mission, you better pick them carefully, Captain. You choose three faces you won't get tired of looking at. Choose three temperaments you can put up with during those long months. That's the best advice I can give you.
Yes, sir.
You ever had a mission this long, Captain?
Oh, no, sir. My longest tour was 6 months.
I remember my first long tour. We had an outpost on Callisto then, and I chose the crew myself. I picked the highest rated man I could. A real crack crew, Captain Taylor. But I didn't pay any attention to temperament, and by the end of the first year, one of my men had killed another. And then the rest hated each other so much that the mission had to be aborted. So don't you worry about service records so much, Captain. Pick guys you can live with.
I still don't know what the mission is, Colonel Deegan.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Well, you and your men are to set up a permanent or semi-permanent station on planet A-15 in the Antares system. You'll construct a radio station to provide free contact with Earth and ships in the vicinity. You'll provide an emergency landing area for ships in distress, but not a way station. To do all this, you'll have to spend many months in astronomical observation in order to keep track of all conditions involving space traffic. And you'll do anything else we want you to do.
Yes, sir.
There'll be a 4-week briefing session for you and your men as soon as you've determined who they are. Start collecting those service records. Choose your men and report back to me. Oh, and one other thing. Remind me to tell you about the magician. So these are your choices, Captain Taylor.
Yes, sir.
Let me see now. Lieutenant Carlos Esquia, co-pilot, born Santa Rosa, Argentina, age 26, 4 years interstellar experience, class rank 4, psych rating excellent. Esquia. Speak English?
Oh, yes, sir. Also French, Spanish, Italian, and Russian.
Sounds like salad dressing. Lieutenant Gary Flack, navigator, born Birmingham, Alabama, age 26, 3 years, interstellar, class rank 7, psych rating, excellent. And the third man, Sergeant William Bart, general crewman, born New York City, age 27, interstellar 5, psych rating, good.
Yeah, that's it, sir. Do you think you might tell me about it now? You mentioned a magician.
Oh, yes, that's right, Captain. Well, it's not a difficult problem, just a bit unusual.
In what way?
Well, when you arrive on A-15, you'll have to dispossess someone.
Madre de Dios, Captain. You mean there's somebody living on that hunk of rock?
That's right, Esquia. Around the year 2041, there were a lot of wildcat merchant ships beachcombing the Antares system after false rumors of gold were spread. Well, the United Space Federation stopped it finally. However, one of those vessels left a prospector on A-15.
You mean marooned there, Captain?
Well, they don't really know, Sergeant, but he's been there ever since, surviving God knows how. His name is Corsini, and Colonel Deegan says he's probably a little mad.
After 14 years, what else could he be?
What are we supposed to do with him, Captain?
We'll take him into custody. Put him on the first supply ship that arrives after our base is established.
Well, how long will that be?
About 2 months.
Sir, what was that you said about him being a magician?
Well, that's the only background information we have, Sergeant. That prior to becoming a space prospector, he was a stage magician. Right now, the supposition is that he fancies himself as king of the planet.
Well, he may not want to abdicate, Captain.
Yeah, we'll humor him. Tell him the Earth government wants to give him an official welcome as ruler of another sovereign state. All right. Now, briefing begins at 1400 hours today. From now on, all sessions will be at 0800 every morning, excluding Sundays, until blastoff. The worst thing about it is the wind. It's warm, and it never stops. Dear Helena, it's taken us almost 6 weeks to build the base that is both our control headquarters and our home. The truth is, I was sorry to see the work finished, because the crew can only start getting restless. That's why I decided it was time to complete another part of our mission.
Men, starting tomorrow, we're going to hunt up our friend Corsini the Great.
Well, you sure there is such a guy, Captain? We haven't seen one sign of him since we've been here.
Maybe he made himself invisible, huh?
Or maybe he died a long time ago and nobody knows it, huh?
Well, that might be true, Lieutenant. But just the same, we'll make up a searching party that'll fly the copter in a circle covering a radius of 100 miles. If we don't spot him the first time, we'll make temporary camp at the perimeter of that circle and cover another 100 miles the next day. We'll keep doing that until we have our man.
Or his body, huh?
Either one. Who goes, Captain? Well, two men will be needed here, Sergeant. One at the ship and one at the transmitter. So, I go and Lieutenant Flack goes with me.
Well, that suits me, Captain.
We'll go full battle dress, Lieutenant. This Corsini may be harmless, but we won't take any chances.
Captain, look, there he is.
Hey, that's what I call luck. We haven't been out more than 2 hours.
Well, he's afraid of us. Look at him run.
How the heck does he live out here?
You suppose he's eating that green stuff?
Yeah, remember what they said at the briefing. It's edible. Tastes like boiled lettuce, only not as good.
Hey, Corsini looks fat. So it must be nourishing.
Yeah. Set it down, Lieutenant. We'll catch up to him on foot. Corsini! Corsini! We want to talk to you. Help you.
Should I fire a shot, Captain?
No. We don't want to scare him any more than he is right now.
Look, Captain. He is down. He is tripped.
Now's the time, Lieutenant. Mr. Corsini, my name is Captain Joel Taylor, USSC.
Get away from me. Leave me alone.
It's all right. It's all right, Mr. Corsini. We haven't come to hurt you. We're delegates from Earth. We came to invite you to pay us a visit.
You don't belong here. I didn't give you permission to land. You are here illegally.
We mean you no harm. The Earth government has sent us here to ask you to Washington as our official guest. You see, our starship is only 80 miles from here, and you can stay at the camp until the next ship arrives from Earth.
No, I won't go. I refuse.
Well, it's for your own good, Mr. Corsini.
This is my planet. Mine. Invaders. That's what you are.
Captain, look out. Spin him around, Captain.
Lieutenant, wait. Don't hit him.
Oh,
for Pete's sake, you may have killed him.
Well, he was trying to kill you, wasn't he?
It's okay, he's still breathing. Help me get him back to the helicopter. I was hoping we could bring back a guest. Looks like we've got a prisoner. Mr. Corsini? Can I talk to you?
What do you want?
Now, look, I know how you feel about this so-called invasion of your home, but believe me, our intentions are peaceful.
Your intention is to rob me of my planet.
Mr. Corsini, nobody owns a planet. The Space Federation made that clear 15 years ago.
This is my world, Captain. My kingdom.
Well, it's a poor kingdom, isn't it? No food, no company. You didn't come here willingly.
No. They put me here. Those people on the ship. You see, I was a stowaway. I thought I might make my fortune in space. Oh, they laughed at me, called me crazy. But then, when they couldn't find the girl they sought, they called me a Jonah and left me here. They didn't know that it would become my kingdom.
I see.
You'd better let me free, Captain. It would be better for all of you.
I'm sorry, Mr. Corsini.
I've learned to do things here. Things so horrible you couldn't conceive of them. I'll bring plagues on you, like Moses did to the pharaohs of Egypt. I'll bring terrible plagues down on you. Yes, like Moses. I'll torment you until you beg me to stop.
Look, we'll talk soon again, Mr. Corsini.
Oh, you'll be sorry. You'll be sorry you ever came to my world, Captain. I warn you, the plagues.
I tried to talk to him, Askia, but it's no use. He's irrational.
You know what I think? He won't eat our food, but he does not refuse our whiskey. Give him a slug with a few bye-bye drops.
Maybe we'll do that.
Captain! Captain, wake up!
What is it, Askia?
He's the magician, Corsini.
What about him?
He is gone. I went in to bring him the whiskey with the sleeping stuff, and he was gone. I don't see how he could have done it.
He was chained, Askia. There's no way he could get out of...
But he did.
He's a magician, all right, an escape artist.
All right. Then we have to do it all over again. Okay, we'll track Corsini tomorrow and hold him this time.
What was that? Sounded like Bart. Come on. Sergeant, what's the matter?
What water, Captain? The water! The water!
What about it?
I woke up thirsty. I went to the water tank. I poured this.
Madre de Dios. Look at that, Captain.
Well, it looks red. Red and thick.
I tasted it, Captain. I drank some before I saw what it looked like. It's blood, Captain. The water has all been turned to blood.
Thus saith the Lord, in this thou shalt know that I am the Lord. Behold, I will smite with the rod that is in mine hand upon the waters which are in the river, and they shall be turned to blood, and thou shalt loathe to drink of the water. As the magician of planet A-15 proved that he really is the Lord of his world, and as we all know, the plagues numbered more than one, we'll see what other numbers Corsini the Great has planned for our adventurers in space when we return with Act Two. A-15, the four-man crew on the lonely outpost feel the cold chill of terror. Corsini the Great, the marooned magician, had seemed like comic relief when they contemplated their assignment of capture and containment. But now, with his chains dangling free, the magician gone, and their precious drinking water turned to blood, the dread they feel is almost supernatural.
Let's stop all this speculating. Now, I think it's obvious what happened here. Corsini slipped out of his bond somehow and contaminated the tank.
But how, Captain? Where did he get whole blood on this nothing planet?
The thing we have to do is find a new source of water.
Well, we better. Our supply ship won't be here for another 2 weeks.
There ain't any water holes on this planet. No lakes, no rivers.
We'll just have to dig for it, Sergeant, that's all.
You mean underground well?
Well, it rains on A-15, doesn't it? There's vegetation. That means there's water somewhere, and we'll find it. Either that or die.
So, we will dig and pray for rain.
Dear Helena, it's raining today. Raining hard. I can't tell you how happy we were to feel those first few drops. Every container you can imagine is out there gathering up the precious water that's coming our way. Especially since 10 hours of continuous digging produced nothing resembling an underground source of water. We might have all been dead in a few days if the rain hadn't come like a gift from heaven. And tomorrow, rain or shine, we go out again in search of the man who was responsible for our predicament. Magician of A-15. But I can tell you this much. None of us are amused by that crazy old man anymore.
There he is, Captain. Right out in the open.
Yeah. Not running this time.
You know what I think? I think he's not afraid of us anymore. Where did he go, Captain?
Behind that hill, I'd say.
I don't like it. I don't like the fact that he is not afraid. And you know something else?
What?
I am.
Oh, he's just a crazed old man, a skier. I'll tell you what. You stay here and cover me. I'll go to the rise and see if I can spot him.
Sure, dear Captain.
Corsini! Where are you?
Captain! Captain!
Eskia, what are you shooting at?
Look, Captain! It's a frog! A giant frog!
You're out of your mind, Eskia. There isn't any animal life on this planet.
No, look, behind the hill. What do you call that thing?
It's impossible.
Captain,
This whole planet is impossible.
So you didn't catch up with Corsini, huh?
We caught up with him, all right. Only he changed himself into a frog.
What are you talking about, a skier?
It was a frog, Sergeant. A monster, maybe 15 feet tall. So there goes Colonel Deegan's theory about the planet not supporting life.
Well, now, we don't know if the thing was indigenous. Maybe it was brought here.
By who, Captain? Corsini the Great?
This is crazy. I mean, first the water turns to blood, and now you see big... Hey, you hear something?
What sounds like... an aircraft or something.
Wait. Look at the stars. Over there. They're usually bright as diamonds.
Something's coming from over there.
Maybe it's some planet phenomenon.
The sky's getting dark. That's what's happening.
Listen to that sound. It sounds like insects.
Hey, that's what it is. Insects. Flies. Gnats. Billions of them. Look out, they're coming for us.
No!
Take cover. Back to the shelter.
We're beaten alive.
Hurry!
Hurry!
All right. Let's hear it. How bad is it, Lieutenant?
Well, pretty bad, Captain. Those damn flies didn't get many bites out of us, but they did manage to get into the food supply.
But everything was sealed up tight.
They ate right through the containers.
Good Lord.
Is it all gone? Out of it?
Whatever's left is inedible. Scare. It's full of maggots.
First, no water. Now, no food. What do we do, Captain?
We do have water, Skier, remember?
Yeah, but I doubt if it's going to rain food, Captain.
We'll eat grass if we have to. The stuff is edible, remember? Corsini thrived on it.
Yeah, well, this is Corsini's doing, Captain. It has to be. He's trying to drive us off.
He can't control nature, Lieutenant.
Well, I'm not so sure. Maybe he's a better magician than you think.
Captain! Captain!
Not what? What's the matter, Willie?
I just made an engine inspection, Captain. Something's gotten into them. Clogged the exhaust tubes.
Flies, maybe?
Well, some kind of barnacle. Tough as steel, Captain. I couldn't scrape them off. I couldn't even pry them off. It'll take a month to clean them out.
Well, then, maybe we better start cleaning right now.
What is the matter with you, Taylor? You think you can solve every problem just by giving an order?
It's my job to give orders, Askia, and my title is Captain.
Well, let me tell you the facts of life, Captain. It's about time we... Oh!
What is it?
My leg. I just touched it here. Sharp pain.
Lieutenant, you're a medic. Take a look.
Oh, ow. I can't sit down. The pain of...
What's going on now? Let's see that leg, Skia.
Oh, look. Boils. I am covered with boils.
Yeah, the same with me. Look at them all over me. Captain, look at your arm.
It must be some kind of infection.
Well, maybe those flies... They're on my feet. I can't stand up.
What's going on? Captain, let's get off this rotten planet.
Don't you see what's happening? The plagues. The plagues of Egypt.
Now, Skia, let's not get carried away.
Think about it. Blood, frogs, flies, gnats. What next? What did they call the next one?
Oh, wait, I remember. A murine of cattle, whatever that means.
And we don't have any cattle, Lieutenant.
Yeah, but we have a ship, Captain. That's as precious as cattle were in biblical days. And a murine might be the same as barnacles.
And boils. The plague of boils. Are you telling me that is a coincidence?
No, I'm not saying that. The truth is, Corsini the magician, he said something about bringing down the plagues of Egypt.
And that's what he's doing. Captain, we can't beat somebody with powers like that.
I'm not ready to admit he has any powers.
Well, hey, where are you going, Captain?
I'm taking the copter out.
Alone?
Yes, alone. I'm going to find Corsini. I don't know if he does have anything to do with what's happening, but I intend to find out. Corsini!
Garcini, come out and talk!
Come to me, Captain. My subject, come to me.
All right. I'm coming.
Kneel, subject.
Look, Corsini.
Kneel, I said.
All right. I'll kneel. Satisfied?
Now you may speak, subject.
I want to know something. These things that have been happening to us. How do you do it? I know you're not supposed to ask a magician that question.
It is God's magic, not mine.
But it's your magic wand, isn't it?
I have been given powers, yes. And you have not seen their full scope.
Corsini, I came to tell you these tricks have got to stop at once. Or we'll consider you an enemy. We will ignore the order we have to bring you home safely. We'll kill you, Corsini.
Go back, Captain.
Up. Oh. What happened to you? What went on here? Flack, Willie, what is it?
Oh, boulders, Captain. Gigantic boulders.
What? Stones, Captain. Great big stones from the sky.
The Lord knows where they came from. They dropped right out of nowhere. Knocked us all down.
Well, then where are they? If there were stones, where are they now?
Well, they're gone. All of them. Hailstones, Captain. That's what they were. That must be the seventh plague.
Now look, there weren't any stones and there aren't any plagues. We're being fooled. We're being tricked.
Lieutenant, well, what's the eighth plague? What's going to happen to us next?
I can tell you that. If Corsini sticks to the script, it'll be locusts.
Oh, no.
There will probably be another swarm like the flies and the gnats.
I can't take too much more of this, Captain.
But we'll be prepared this time. We'll make sure we get inside the ship at the first sign of things. We'll use the heat guns to blast them. And if they get too troublesome, we'll blast off and burn them with our rocket fire. Now, is that understood?
We are not going to have to wait long, Captain. They are coming now.
We won't have time to get to the ship.
Get those heat guns ready.
Look, there are millions of them, Captain.
Pick up your weapons. Start firing.
Captain, look. They are not just locusts.
What are they?
They're some kind of insect.
Look at the size of them.
They got faces. All of them. Faces.
Mama. They look like my mother. My poor dead mom.
Dorothy. They look like my Dorothy.
It's just a trick. Another rotten trick.
Fire! Fire those guns!
I can't, Captain. It's Louise.
Oh, Helena.
It's Helena's face.
Captain. Captain, where are you?
Back. Is that you?
I can't see. I'm blind. Somebody help me.
Look, everybody stay where you are. Don't move.
They blinded us, Captain. The locusts.
No, we are not blind. There just isn't any light.
No light?
It's another plague, another trick of Corsini. Darkness. The plague of darkness.
Well, how do you know? How can you be sure?
Just stay calm. It'll pass, Lieutenant, like all the rest.
Well, when, Captain?
I don't know.
Captain!
Corsini! Where are you?
I'm here, Captain. I can see you, but you can't see me.
Turn the lights on, Corsini. I know you can do it.
Yes, Captain, you're right. I can do it. I can give you back the light. But I will not. Unless you and your men make me a solemn promise.
We can't make deals, Corsini. We're acting on orders.
Very well. If you wish the plague of darkness to remain with you forever.
Listen to him, Captain.
Keep us back our eyes, Corsini. We will do what you ask. Tell him, Captain.
Please, Captain.
What are your demands, Corsini?
That you leave, Captain. That you get back into your ship. and leave my planet at once?
It can't be that immediate. There are preparations. The ship has to be thoroughly checked, refueled.
Do what must be done. But be off my planet by the next 3 suns. Is that understood?
All right, Corsini. I agree.
Your solemn word.
My word, Corsini. Now, give us back the light.
It's yours, Captain. You leave by the next 3 suns.
We're not leaving. We'll radio headquarters and tell them the situation, but we won't leave unless they order it. Well, I got the word. We're to hold our ground, Lieutenant, and do what we can to end the menace that Corsini represents.
Well, Captain, what about the next plague?
Oh, yeah, there will be a next plague, won't there? That'll be the death of the firstborn.
Firstborn? What does that mean? None of us have any kids.
Oh, no, we don't have children. I mean the death of the firstborn among ourselves. And since I'm the oldest, I guess that means me.
Well, if the great Corsini runs true to form, the men on planet A-15 will soon be without a captain. But can the angel of death, which passed over the homes of the Israelites to smite the firstborn children of the Egyptians, find its way into outer space? We'll find out when we return to Act 3. Fiercely on planet A-15, whistling through the slate-gray hills as if whispering a warning to the 4 men who wait for tragedy to strike again. But the man who is threatened most refused to show his fear. He's Captain Joel Taylor, an officer of the United States Space Command. He is their leader, but he is also young and afraid.
Nothing's going to happen. It can't. Now, take my word for it.
How do you know? Corsini's made good on all the other plagues. Why not this one?
Because all the other plagues were imaginary. That's why. The water wasn't blood. It was water. Good drinking water.
Are you kidding? I tasted that stuff.
You tasted what Corsini wanted you to taste. You saw what Corsini wanted you to see. And the frog, was that imaginary? Well, of course it was. Just like all the other hallucinations. The flies, the gnats, the barnacles on our ship.
You mean we scraped those things off for nothing?
And we suffered those boils for nothing because they weren't real.
They hurt for real.
Well, those giant hailstones. You saw them too, but they melted away when you opened your eyes. How come none of us were ever hurt, bruised, even scratched by one of those things? Bitten by any of those giant insects?
Well, you're right about that, Captain.
See, and the faces on those giant locusts. We all see different faces. They had to come out of our own minds.
Yes, exactly. It's all come out of our own minds, because that's where Corsini the Great operates.
You mean he's a hypnotist?
I'm sure of it, Lieutenant. He was a stage magician, probably a professional hypnotist in his career on Earth. But something happened to him on this planet. In the 14 years he was marooned, his powers increased in some way, and increased 100 times.
But he can't really hurt us. Is that what you mean?
He can't cause us any physical harm. And that's why I'm not worried about the 10th plague.
Well, I'm glad you're not, Captain, since you're the firstborn.
And I'm also the captain of this expedition. So, let's get some sleep, and let's go look for our hypnotist in the morning. Armed.
Captain Taylor.
Hey, what is going on?
I'm trying to wake the captain.
What time is it?
It's early, but I wanted to see if he's okay. Captain, wake up.
What is it?
Thank the Lord. You were sleeping so soundly for a minute, I thought.
Lieutenant, you are a nervous wreck. Now, go to sleep.
No. Maybe we should get an early start. We don't know where Corsini is right now. We might have to make several sorties to find him. Okay, somebody wake the sergeant.
Go ahead, Strack. You are good at waking people.
Hey, Willie. Hey, wake up. He's a heavy sleeper, all right. Willie, what's the matter with you? Come on.
Oh, no.
What's wrong?
Oh, Captain, he won't wake up. I mean, he's lying there with his eyes open, but he doesn't move. Madre de Dios.
Get away. Let me see him.
He looks dead.
Yes, he looks dead. And he is dead. And I think he's been dead for more than a few hours.
Could it be? Corsini? No, that's not possible. Even if it was the plague, that would be all wrong. He wasn't the firstborn.
No, stop this. I told you, the plagues are imaginary. Corsini can't harm us.
He harmed Willie. He killed him, Captain.
But he isn't the oldest. It's wrong.
He is the oldest.
What?
He is. I knew it. And Corsini knew it, too. God knows how. It is magic, Captain. It is really magic.
Eskia, you don't know what you're talking about. Willie must have had a heart attack.
And he wasn't the oldest. He was 27. The captain's 28.
No, that is not true. Willie, he got drunk the night of the blast-off party, and he told me about it. He's been lying about his age for years. He didn't want to wash out of space service. He was 31. 31. And now, he's dead.
Eskia, wait a minute.
Say you don't believe it now, Captain. Go ahead. Call it hypnotism.
No, Eskia, that's what it wasn't.
Well, what do you mean, Captain?
Everything else that happened to us was an illusion, but death is real. Willie's death is real. Look. This pinpoint of blood on the back of his head.
You think that caused it?
Somebody was here last night, Lieutenant. Somebody was here while we all slept. Corsini must have crept into the place and slipped a needle into poor Willie's brain. It's no illusion, Lieutenant. It's cold-blooded murder.
That filthy coward.
It's also something else. It's the last trick up his sleeve.
Then let's get him right now.
We'll get him, all right. Get the ship ready for blast-off.
What?
You heard me. I want to leave A-15 within the hour, just as he expects us to do. I want us to blast off this godforsaken planet as soon as we can.
And let him get away with it?
Oh, we won't be gone long. Only long enough to make that madman think we're gone. Then, we're coming back.
Well, what's the strategy, Captain?
We'll make a shallow orbit around the planet and then head back for the original campsite. Unless I miss my guess, our magician friend will be in the vicinity, celebrating his great victory.
And then what?
We bring the ship down, Eskia. Rockets, full blast to break for landing. You understand?
Yes, sir, Captain. I understand.
Now, come on in, Captain. Have a seat.
Thank you, Colonel Dagan.
I don't think I'd have recognized you, Captain Taylor, if you hadn't been announced.
It's been 3 years, Colonel.
Yes, 3 years.
And I probably look 10 years older, don't I?
Well, I hear you had it pretty rough out there.
Yeah, it was rough.
When I first read your report on what happened, the death of the crewman, the extermination of Corsini, well, maybe he preferred being nothing but a smudge of gray ashes on the planet he loved so much.
Yep. That's all that was left of him, a smudge of gray ashes. We spotted him at our campsite, waving his arms at us with insane glee, and then we bricked the ship and gave him the full blast of the rockets. He was incinerated in seconds. He didn't suffer, I can promise you that.
But you did, Captain, didn't you?
Yes. We suffered.
Want to tell me about it?
I don't know how it really happened. With the magician dead, we returned to our routine chores. We operated our transmitter, took astronomical data, kept the space traffic flowing through the Antares system. But then we found that the work wasn't enough. The talk wasn't satisfying. The movies weren't entertaining. We got to know each other, all right. And the more we knew, the more we disliked each other. And then the dislike turned to hate. We began to hate each other's faces, voices, habits. even each other's virtues. We began to quarrel. We began to fight. And finally, we began to kill.
Yes, Kia.
Yeah. I don't know what started the argument. I don't think Lieutenant Flack meant to fire that heat gun. But he did. I had to lock him up, Colonel. I had to keep him in restraints until the supply ship arrived almost a month later. And I had to bury Askia's body in that gray sand. Dear God Almighty.
All right, easy, Captain.
We didn't know how well off we were when Corsini was alive. When he was after us, his plagues drew us together, Colonel. They united us against a common enemy, made us a unit. For months, he gave us something to occupy our minds, something to fight for, to live for. But when the magician died, there was nothing else. Only space. Only that half-dead planet. And boredom. And each other.
Yes, Captain. I understand.
That was the worst plague of all, Colonel. The 11th plague. Loneliness.
Loneliness. One of the saddest words in the English language. Who can imagine the terrible sense of detachment that our future spacemen will feel when separated, not just from the people and the society they know, but the Earth on which the human race was born. But they'll go anyway, won't they? And it won't be just rockets that will propel man to other worlds. It will be the most human trait of all, curiosity. I'll be back with a final word. Before man and woman begin to colonize the planets. But when they do, can you imagine how many new mysteries will unfold? We hope the Mystery Theater will still be around to relate those stories to new generations of listeners. And who knows, if we find life on the worlds out there in space, we might have a whole new audience with green scales and built-in antennae. Why, they might not even need a radio to hear us. Our cast included Russell Horton, Ian Martin, and Lloyd Batista. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
After Pete Stein got his, I got an army buddy to check for me. Coslow's stretch was over September 28th, 1976. 17 days before Pete died. October 15th.
October 15th? That's the same day that Phil Fowler...
Yeah.
Oh, are you suggesting that the killer had anything to do with Pete's death?
Well, that's what I gotta talk to you about. Because Andy and Tom died on the same date, too. I want to tell you, I'm scared stiff, Harry. I figure one of us has got to be next.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.
goodbye night. That's why you'll love the CertiPerfect Sleeper. Luxurious top comfort plus deep inner support. You get both with every perfect sleeper. So remember, be a perfect sleeper. Buy a perfect sleeper, perfect sleeper. Buy CertiPerfect. It's a healthy investment in yourself.